I want to introduce a project called Flowchain. Our company was located in Singapore, but in fact, we started from Taiwan. I believe Flowchain is a new concept, so today I'm going to introduce what it is and what we are doing. I'm going to introduce the use case of Flowchain, how we use Flowchain, and the combining with the IPFS, which is very popular, to build a storage technology, storage network, but it's still in the developing concept, so we don't have product yet. But of course, I will tell you where you can get the code. This is about me. Previously, there's a magazine which introduced about our technology. If we want to explain Flowchain, then
we
want to say, like, we are the AI multiplier, the IoT plus blockchain. The differences are shown here. First, we started from scratch, targeted at IoT, large scale demand, and also the 5G demand. I mean, it is not the existing open source project. About our core technologies, first is our operating system. We can embed it into chips. I brought one with me today, so I will present to you later on. And we have a hybrid blockchain system architect. It is a private chain technology. In terms of public chain, three can be combined. One is the user brand and the Hyperledger Fabric. And the third one will be introduced later on. Third interesting feature is the computing pool. And for the second core technologies, there are several features. First, we support edge AI computing. And the name was designed based on our feature, which is the data flow blockchain. And finally, in 2017 in Canada, we released the virtual blockchain, which is an algorithm. This is also designed by us. So, you haven't heard of Flowchain, then in fact, we are working on AI plus IoT. The difference is that we consider about software and the hardware integration, and we also have chips. And second, we target at P2P topology. And all of them are open source and open standards. And fourth, we have the very rigid dynamic paper being released, two of which are being published on the ACN journal. You can find them on our official website.
And
all of the
intents,
they have proof concept. First is the open source. This is the GitHub. And we are reconstructing the code. Before the end of September, we will update. Currently, there is only some proof concept and code. And we're going to release the version very soon, and I'm going to show you a feature later on. Then how we achieve the AI OT, there are four highlights. First of all, targets at the data flow. This is where we get the name for this technology.
Data flow is like this.
In the future, in the large scale of connected internet devices, since the topology is very complicated, just look like left-hand side, then there are many connecting points and very rich combinations, connections and
complicated. Hyperledger Fabric 在1.6,
the Hyperledger Fabric 0.6 proposed the BFT. It cannot support such a large scale and complicated IoT device. So if we want to apply this algorithm on IoT, we need to revise it or research
the algorithm.
Flowchain algorithm can turn the topology into a very simple structure. This will give us two benefits. First, for the searching of nodes, it's very easy, so it takes less time. The connections is very simple, very streamlined. So you can see the comparison between the right-hand side and the left-hand side. In the future, it's 5G plus IoT.
Well,
computing accounts for majority, or data accounts for majority. Well, it is the motivations starting this technology. If data matters, then there is a data trust, is a very key concept. Then in 2017, I remember the Ericsson mentioned in his white paper about the 5G plus IoT technology pain points, two of which are being worked on by Flowchain. First is the device identification, how you verify the identity of the devices, so that to prove the data is reliable. For me, I've been working on the embedded or the drive development. It's very natural to develop an operation system. So this is the devil drive. We can embed it in chips. It has a strong feature. In the past, when we designed the drive or kernel for Linux, we used the
CD.
However, at the end of 2017, we used JavaScript to write it. So it is now 100% JavaScript written system. First of all, it's because of many chips. They have the JavaScript engine, like the Huawei's engine chip with the JavaScript engine, and then Node. So junior hardware, they have different features of chips with similar engine than with this. We can apply the same technology in various ways. So first is about data flow, we simplify the process, and second is about the security of devices, so we design the operating system. And third is a hybrid blockchain. I will talk more later on, but of course you can see from this picture the concept of hybrid blockchain. So it's a public one,
and a private one.
For the public one, it provides storage and computing. For example, today in this video we have 100 IoT devices. They will form a private blockchain, but they need computing power and storage. Then they need the nodes on the public blockchain to get the storage space and the computing power. The public blockchain can deploy on
cloud.
In terms of necessity, it is needed because in the devices in the private blockchain, they need to recognize and trust each other. Otherwise, I don't know. Then otherwise, they don't know whether the data can be trusted or not. Similarly, the devices put the data on nodes for computing, then the AI node need to verify whether the data are fake or not.
So we can use the Flowchain. Later on, I will show you a key technology from the Flowchain. In the future, we have the plan to promote the concept just like an e-computing pool. Now we are now working on the test with the development version of video with JSONL, which is popular. It has 400 and 500 JSONL development versions connected to the Flowchain. So the for the IoT devices, when they need the computing power, then the smart contracts and the DApp can assign the task to the nodes for computing. That is the hybrid chain. Now, I show you more about the hybrid blockchain. The private chain is IoT, and the public chain can provide AI computing capability and storage. This is the architecture.
IoT
devices are on the private chain responsible for data collection, data transmission to the public chain for computing the storage. The AI models are on the public chain. The AI nodes, you can see, we call it the miners or block producers. But most people will call them the miners. The miners are responsible for storage and computing. After the storage and the computing, then the miners can get the Flowchain's token as a reward. This is a typical mining mechanism of incentive, but it's not the focus of my presentation. The miners can verify the devices authenticity and how to judge whether it's a fake or not. Then we have a PPKI, which is a key technology from the Flowchain. So far, the Flowchain has the following features. It's developed from scratch for IT, and it considers the data flow, and it's a hybrid structure, and PPKI safety certification technology. I have mentioned in the Ericsson's white paper, there are four key technologies and the four pain points. The first one is device safety, the Flowchain PPKI, and the real time, the data transmission, data processing. From the 5G's features, we know that 3G, the mobile phones can send the images, and for 4G can enable the watching of the images, and then for 5G, we can have the real-time video streaming. So based on the IDC's 2018 report, by 2025, the whole world will have 30% of the time is real-time data. So for the IoT blockchain, the 5G plus IoT blockchain, they are different. If it's the 5G plus IoT, the device safety certification and the real-time data processing, these are something we should consider. In the past, at the Flowchain, we worked on IoT solutions, but because of the customer's needs, we add blockchain to it to resolve the device safety and anti-tampering issue, and also for the real-time data implementation. So we spent 1.5 and 2 years on the research and development of algorithm. We have introduced the hybrid blockchain and also PPKI. Now we show you the architecture of PPKI. It's a set of data.
It,
puzzle and the lambda puzzle are not the focus of the presentation. But in the previously mentioned three papers, the algorithm and the pseudocode is in the paper. PPKI just like the token. Also, it's similar to Google's OFM certificate, or like the message code, or the password, the message password of mobile phones. It can collect the PPKI data from the network. For example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And after 10 seconds, if there is a new person joining us, we can ask him about the PPKI. If he cannot tell 1, 2, 3, 6, 5, 6, then we know he is not here previously. So we can send the PPKI to the device, and then we can authenticate the identity. It changes every 1 in 1,000 seconds.
So, for example,
we have a different scenario. The PPKI sensor is out of power, and I change the battery after 1 minute. So within the time period, it cannot receive the signal. When other devices ask about the PPKI number, it cannot answer rightly. So it's just like the P2P authentication of the device identity. It's called PPKI. So from the miner or the public chain through broadcasting, it's sent to every IoT device, for example. We have three meeting rooms here. The PPKI has only one public chain. We use Ethereum as a public chain. On the Ethereum, we have a sidechain node or off-chain node. So it goes through Ethereum to calculate PPKI and broadcast it to the private chain.
Puzzle
is used for the data migration.
Lambda
is for the public key to replace the traditional public key. Traditionally, it's really time consuming. Some chips and devices have no crypto engine. It needs the software for computing, so it's time consuming. Even it has the crypto engine.
The 256 hash
for each second is really power consuming and has a large memory footprint. So the PPKI has the certificates for migration and for public key. It has no private key. There is no the private key design now, so it's mainly designed for IoT. The lambda, it's in the time slice. The current design is 1 in 1,000 seconds, so 1,000 PPKI keeps broadcasting. The devices capture the data and use a pyro. Puzzle to migration. So the puzzle is just like the private key for migration. After the migration, the public key is used to make it into hash. It has a D1 to a D4. This is the data slices. Each data slice, the IoT device uses a puzzle and a lambda for migration. After the migration, it can compute a hash value. Then the hash string will be made into DHG structured data, that is IPFS, use it, that is the data chunks. If we have full data, after receiving the data, the IoT devices make it into DHE structure. The DHE, later on I will show how the DHE is processed back to the IoT devices. For example, we have a sensor here. Each second it can capture 4 pieces of data. So it has a full slice or full chunks. Each chunk or slice, how can we have the verification? This is the flowchain's quite a good solution. For example, the first device slice is D1. D1 is for the signature for others. For example, today I give out a number. The number is 100. For example, temperature is 100. Then the 100 degrees. We should have the slice or the block verification. I need 2 to 3 nodes for signature. The signature should be very fast, so we can use PPKI to do that. For those who trust me, they can give me signature. This is the meaning of this slide. So we go through the signature of the data chunks. The signatures from those who trust me is the opposite to the logic of consensus algorithm. For the flowchain, I know you trust me, so you help me with the signature.
So the data chunks
will be sent to other nodes who trust me for signature.
After that,
each node will make it into virtual block data structure. This is not the focus of my presentation today. You can go to the website for details. For the D3 data flow, the green part, you can see a lot of data chunks. We can make them into DAG. We can use a SHA-256 to make it into a hash and put it into the block. This is a traditional way of a blockchain data structure. I cannot give you all the details in a limited time, but I can tell you the MOCO tree. For the storage of transaction, for example, two transactions, transaction A or transaction 1 is the DH hash. That is the overall technology and IPFS. What's the relationship with it? From 3.2, we can show you 1.2 on the identity authentication. For 3.2, it's the virtual block. The virtual block includes the data chunks and the hash. The data chunks and the hash include the data itself and the data storage. The data itself is sent to IPS node for storage. That is the data. And for the data virtual blocks and the hash will be put onto the ledger. So the blockchain concept is separate the ledger for the data. For the virtual block, ledger is put onto the Ethereum or the Hyperledger Fabric. The hedges can be exchangeable. For example, the meeting room today, the meeting room, the sensors can have a ledger on the Hyperledger Fabric. I can give the ledger to you or to another company.
Then
from the IPMS, you can get access to the data.
And then
the data authenticity, what is the authenticity of the data, whether we can verify it and how to verify. You can give it to the miners with the GPU and the miner's resource for the verification. So the data and the ledger will be done by the miner for the verification. It's a transaction and then verification. That is the work of the miner with the verification of the data, and they can get the awards. I was skip this part. Now, brief conclusion. From the virtual block, the DAG will be built for MOCO trees and insert DAG into the new block. the virtual block will be put into the new blocks and will be broadcasted to each miner for verification. After verification, data is put on the IPFS and the hash and DAG virtual blocks will be put onto the Hyperledger Fabric. So the data and the ledger are separate.
We want to do it
because of
something that we all know.
The P2P is highly reliable.
We don't want to go through any agents for verification. So this is the decentralized
concept.
Why it is still an ideal concept? Because after we done any research, there are so many problems awaiting to be solved. The first is how can devices verify each other? If all the devices are connected to the cloud can help us verify the identity of devices.
But
without the cloud, how to identify the device would be a problem. And this is a
Ericsson.
There are many ways that does not support such a data flow, so we need to separate
this
flow. For us, we target this. I want to refer to the research done by Ericsson.
So
their white paper. In their white paper, they mentioned about the enclave technology. So it's based on hardware to achieve security, trust computing. So just explain it simply, that is, we need a chip to do this. So I bring this with me, just hang next to my badge. It looks like a USB disk. Inside it, there is the chip of PKI.
What
should we do with it? Now I'm going to show you. So for the above technologies, are introduced quite in a general way. But of course, there's the white paper for you to take a look.
What it is?
This is the Open 3 gateway. This is the gateway.
Open 3 border route.
Do you know what border router is doing?
The
looks like this, the control center for smart house. We take it as a key, and it is named as NCP, and connect to the computer.
So
there will be a flow chain node running on the computer. To match with the
border
router, on the right hand side, there are many FED. The FED means all kinds of facilities at home, like projectors, TV, audio system, horns, etc. They are all using Bluetooth. The bottom layer of the Open 3 is Bluetooth connection, so we can use this to connect to the border router. And the border router can control those devices. If you are camping outside, if you're using the video recorder, the data can be sent to the border router. And the streaming data can be put on the internet for storage or for watching afterwards. When I'm using the border router to control intelligent house or turn on the TV need to
how should
border router convince that the TVs are actually the TV in my room? Have you saw those jokes online? Without security technologies, when I play the music in my car, there are other cars playing the music instead of my own car. So this is related to the device security. It's a very if the example to make you understand, this is the smart home combined with the public blockchain. So what is the public blockchain is doing? If you have a video recorder, after you record the short TV show, you can put them on the public blockchain.
Border router 是一个 USB 的,
border router now is looks like a USB disk, cannot be used alone, you need to combine with other devices. So Flowchain is quite special. We are designing software and also chips. In this August, this will be our first product, but it cannot be used alone. If you want to have a try, probably wait until August, wait until October, we'll launch a series of products. In September, there will be FAD products. In October, there will be a concept model. Before the end of October, we have the development tools for 5G. So together, all of them will turn into a series of products. Because today I'm here to talk about technology, then I will not talk much about our products. And finally, to recap, the role of IoT and 5G. We all know that there are four features: ultra low energy consumption, like LoRa and Bluetooth, and then ultra low latency, especially for the industrial network, we need ultra low latency, and then large scale of IoT connection, which is SDN. In the application layer, or in application scenarios, we need verification. So Ericsson also mentioned about using chips to solve this problem. And about data, by 2020, 30% of the data will be real time, so it's a very key technology. Then the two key technologies are being mentioned today. So 1 minute to go. I want to show you a short video.
Blockchain. It uses pseudonymous public
This is our official website and also pick up my email address and also which ID. If possible, we can communicate more in the future. Thank you.